The Wildcats let me down. The Vipers might be turning things around, and two teams continue their free fall. These are the XFL Power Rankings for Week 4. Here we go. New York Guardians, number 8. Yes, they won this week. Yes, they're 2-2. Yes, they beat the team I gushed about last week. We'll get to that. But yes, I have to keep New York in our bottom spot. This actually has more to do with the performances of the teams around them than New York's actual performance this week. There are some positives to the Guardians game. Matt McGloin didn't play, and backup Luis Perez filled in pretty well. Plus, the defense was absolutely nasty against a team that just hung a 40 spot last week in the LA Wildcats. But the story of this game was more about LA than New York. And because the results of the Vipers and Dragons didn't fall the Guardians' way, even though their spot doesn't change, they've created a much narrower gap than it looked like there was last week. At number 7, we have the DC Defenders at their lowest point of the season. Look, we're almost halfway through the season now. One game cannot decide where a team ends up in these rankings. But this isn't just one game for the Defenders. This isn't even two games running for the Defenders. This is a continuous pattern DC has shown since the beginning of the season. One standout performance in Week 2 against the Guardians aside, and of course, New York has been at the bottom of these rankings for 3 weeks, their Week 1 win over the Dragons had more to do with the Dragons' seemingly mismatched collection of offensive pieces. In the last 2 weeks, DC has been outscored 64-9, while Cardale Jones has thrown under 200 yards, 5 picks, and no TDs, 2 games combined. I've said this before, Danelle Pumphrey is maybe the best running back in the XFL talent-wise, but he's constantly underused and hindered by bad play calling. He's outside the top 5 in rushing yards, while 2 dreadful performances have Jones sitting at number 5 in passing yards. And remember, this guy was supposed to be the best quarterback in this league, or at least one of them. Call me a pessimist, but Jones is subpar at best. Their play calling is stale, and their coaches refuse to get away from their game plan, even though it's been so bad the last 2 weeks. Their 29-0 win over New York was an outlier. This is not a good team, and they'll have to show me something much more for me to think they are. There are 2 teams that I've constantly compared because of how similar they appear to be on paper, and I've already talked about one of them. DC and Dallas are almost the same team. Highly overrated quarterback, tremendous running back that's underused in key spots, and play calling that doesn't recognize the reality of the level of their offensive talent. Once again, Landry Jones had a cataclysmic performance in Dallas's 27-20 loss to Houston. He threw 3 picks to just 1 touchdown, despite his 66% completion percentage. Here's the thing, Jones completes his passes, that's just a given. But completing screens and 2-yard dump-offs and throwing picks on every pass over 7 yards doesn't exactly instill confidence. And what's worse, the coaching staff doesn't seem to understand this, as they have him go out and throw 40 passes a game. And this is while Dallas has a top 3 running back in Cameron Artis Payne. It's absolutely disgusting play calling from a coaching staff that really seems to have no idea what they're actually working with. 2 things put them ahead of DC at this point. They keep their games closer than DC does, and Landry Jones' injury against Houston means they'll be forced to diversify their play calling a little. Remember, in Week 1, while Jones was out, Artis Payne did get carries, and Dallas competed with St. Louis, which had me very positive about Dallas's prospects at the time. Oh, how things change. Coming in at number 5 is the Seattle Dragons. I was very critical of the Dragons last week, calling out Brandon Silvers and their apparent lack of talent. Well, somehow they've managed to begin fixing both of those problems in one go, replacing Brandon Silvers with BJ Daniels. Daniels is a Jim Zorn quarterback. He makes plays with his feet and he scrambles around like a madman. Now, he's no PJ Walker, he's no Jordan Ta'amu, but he injected some much needed life to a lethargic Dragons offense. It's unfortunate he had to make his debut against the buzzsaw that is the St. Louis Battlehawks, but he was at least good enough to keep the Dragons in the game. It doesn't get any easier as the Dragons have to walk into Houston and play the Roughnecks. We might have to wait a week to figure out where the Dragons stand with a more exciting, more dynamic quarterback, but at the very least, they showed us some signs of life. It's the most miraculous jump we've seen in these rankings so far. No, I will not be saying that every week, unless it's true. Now, you remember how I said the Guardians staying at number 8 had more to do with the other teams around them? Well, the Tampa Bay Vipers take the number 4 spot for a similar reason. Are they really the 4th best team in the league in a position to make the playoffs? Debatable. But the Renegades and Defenders have been so bad recently, and Tampa has actually been showing signs of improvement. It looked early on like they'd be the running joke of these rankings. Hell, they were the team the Guardians beat in such a way that I put the Guardians number 1. I'm not going to let myself forget that, and you shouldn't either. And I have to keep saying that because I was right about Cardale Jones and Landry Jones, so I have to keep myself grounded. The Vipers picked up their first win in dominant fashion over the Defenders. If it was a little league game, there would have been dads fighting in the stands about one team running up the score. But each week, they've gotten steadily better. They started off getting crushed by New York, lost in convincing but not dominating fashion to Seattle, competed with the number one Houston Roughnecks in week 3, and now pick up their first win in a rated R performance in week 4. With so many teams trending downward, it's refreshing to see a team that seems to be genuinely going in the right direction. Quietly, Tampa has amassed the most dangerous rushing attack in the league, a two-headed monster where both men are ranked top 3 in rushing yards. Their pass defense continues to be great, and they add a couple turnovers and sacks each game. Are they good enough to compete with St. Louis or Houston? TBD, but they're trending up, and that's what matters. LA remains at number 3, even after a loss to the bottom-ranked team. Look, we're almost halfway through the season. One game can't color my opinion of entire teams the way they could in the first couple weeks. This was the game where LA jumped the shark. Josh Johnson is really, really good. He is, okay? But he's now 1-2 as a starter. It's because he's good in his role. In his first game back, he threw 34 passes in a loss to Dallas. In his second game, LA made a course correction, having Johnson throw just 25 passes. He was marvelous in that role, completing 18 of those passes for 278 yards and 3 touchdowns. Yes, it was against a weak DC defense, but that's what Johnson needs to be. They need to supplement him with a running game. St. Louis has shown exactly how to do this, actually. Instead, LA got overconfident. They drew up 40 pass plays for Johnson this past week. His completion percentage dipped, he threw a crucial pick, and LA lost by a field goal. Johnson needs to throw no more than 30 times a game. LA has some pieces around him, and their defense is at least average, and when it comes to rushing the quarterback, they're top 3 for sure. This is one of those losses that hurts LA because there are only 10 games and they're now 1-3. But I think they will have learned something from Johnson's performance here, and I expect to see the Wildcats that stomped on DC in week 3 from here on out. You know the drill, it's St. Louis at number 2. I've been going back and forth about whether it's the Battle Hawks or the Roughnecks that are truly the best team in the XFL. Of course, the Roughnecks won their matchup, but that was week 2 and so much can change going forward. At the end of the day, you can't jump the number one team in a week they win without extenuating circumstances. St. Louis was great again this week, and they did their St. Louis thing. They don't run up the score, but we know this already, so don't let that margin of victory fool you. Jordan Ta'amu is absolutely phenomenal. He went 20 of 27 for 264 yards and a score, and added 63 yards on the ground. This is exactly what I've been talking about when it comes to LA. The Battlehawks have figured out exactly how many times Ta'amu should be throwing, how to use him in option and gadget plays, and how to grind down their opponents. Their defense doesn't rush the quarterback, but they hit anything that moves in the backfield. They're just a solid team, aren't they? No clear weaknesses and probably the best quarterback in the league to anchor it all. Yes, I'd put Ta'amu edging out PJ Walker just because Ta'amu ranks in the top 5 in both passing and rushing yards, but that's neither here nor there. So yes, it is the Roughnecks remaining at the top of these rankings for the 3rd week in a row. I'm contractually obligated to state how thin the margin is between Houston and St. Louis, but it remains true. Both the Roughnecks and Battlehawks won their games by a touchdown margin, but in both cases, the margin had more to do with the teams putting the clamps on late. That's not really where Houston will find their success though. PJ Walker threw 41 passes and they only attempted 18 rushing plays. It's fairly typical. That being said though, Walker is as good a quarterback as there is in the league. He continues to find new receiving targets, all of whom step up when needed. This week, Cam Phillips caught only one pass, but Nick Hawley and Khalil Lewis combined for 14 catches, 150 yards, and a touchdown after being background players up till now. Houston is just a complete team with a sensational quarterback. And I believe we are on a collision course on XFL Championship Weekend. It's going to be so fun charting these teams for the rest of the season. But as always, if you disagree with any of my rankings here, let me know in the comments down below. Let's discuss. Subscribe for our power rankings every week, plus a very special project I'm so excited to unveil soon. We appreciate you.